The Jolla Coast offers many sights to see, from the Jolla Tidepools to the Scripps Pier. Just off Jolla Shores Drive is the Scripps Institute of Oceanography, established in 1903. As you walk toward the beach, you'll see two arrows pointing left. Between these two arrows are some purple perennial lupines. A little further on the left are stairs which lead to the beach. Nearby, you can see chairs being laid out and arranged for another seaside wedding ceremony. As we turn north from Jolla Shores, we see the Scripps Pier. It's named after Ellen Browning Scripps and is an instrument mounting platform and sampling station. It has measured seawater temperature and salt content once per day since 1916. The trend shows an increase of 3 degrees Fahrenheit per century, evidence of global warming. The underside of the pier is a popular location for photography and video. In 1873, Ellen Browning Scripps worked with her brother James to launch the Detroit Evening News newspaper. This started the Scripps family fortune. She made her first trip to San Diego in 1890 and soon purchased land to establish Miramar Ranch, the area now known as Scripps Ranch, as well as the land where Marine Corps Air Station Miramar currently resides. She was an advocate for science, women's education, and a generous philanthropist. Her name is heard across San Diego County, as in Scripps Elementary, Scripps Memorial and Scripps Mercy Hospitals, Scripps Institute of Oceanography, and the Scripps Pier. Next to the pier are these rocks that look like a whale's spine or skeleton. You can see how they have been sliced across their length. What could have caused the deep etches? That may remain a mystery. But it is a curious rock formation to investigate. Why do the seagulls and pelicans sometimes fly in formation? Each rides the slipstream of the bird in front to conserve energy. In addition, each wing flap pushes air down, and immediately behind that air, an upwash provides lift for the next bird in line. Drought-tolerant hedgehog aloe lined the back of a special place called Cuvier Park. It is named after George Cuvier, the founder of paleontology involving the study of plant and animal fossils. The park is also known as the Wedding Bowl and has the scenic Jolla Coast as a backdrop. The city allows one wedding ceremony per day. It looks to be currently configured for 80 guests in addition to the bride and groom. North of the Wedding Bowl is the People's Wall Traverse. Its height is roughly 15 to 20 feet at the center, and the trail rises on both ends toward the level of the sidewalk. Sometimes people can be seen using it for exercise by hanging on the side and traversing sideways, as the name implies, or climbing straight up the wall to the top. Adjacent to the People's Wall is a section of coastal rock that has been shaped by the sand and waves. Constant pounding and motion has carved the rocks. The sand in the waves provides an abrasive to eat away rock over time. The salt water and sand together act as a leisurely sculptor, creating combinations of jagged and smooth surfaces. Here's an interesting portal formed by the ocean. Given enough time, nature can erode even man-made objects, like these stairs. This area proves to be a thoughtful challenge to navigate above Wipeout Beach. And here's a skimboarder showing us why it's called Wipeout Beach. On the road above, you see an art piece at the Museum of Contemporary Art with canoes and watercraft, titled Pleasure Point. There's also a mural with a sailing ship quoting a line from the movie The Paleface, starring Bob Hope: "Brave men run in my family." The coastal walk is lined with decorative pillars made out of shells and stone. Purple flowers are also situated next to the walkways. It appears no matter which direction you look, the sights are always pleasant. The rhythm of the ocean unlocks a calming effect in our minds. The movement of the wind and the sound of the waves slips us into a mild meditation, helping to reduce stress and heal our troubled souls. Here's another resident of La Jolla enjoying the view and surrounding vegetation. Or maybe there's something else on his mind. The squirrel stuffs his cheek pouches with food in order to carry it back to a safe location to eat. If you look closely, you can see squirrels climbing the rocks in search of food. They get close enough and don't seem too shy. Other times, they run away. This one wonders what we're doing here. Or maybe it stopped just to smell the flowers. This lifeguard station marks the entrance to the children's pool. Its tower has clear views along the coast, from the south to the northeast. The children's pool was built in 1930 as a safe beach area for children to swim and play. Ellen Browning Scripps is a name you'll hear a lot in the La Jolla community. She donated the funds to present the children's pool as a gift to San Diego. A large seawall was constructed to block crashing waves coming in from the west and to keep the kids safe. In the 1990s, seals and sea lions began resting on the secluded beach. On some days, there are hundreds of pelicans that rest here too. From the winter to spring, the area is closed off to people to protect the sea life. Next to the seawall, you'll spot seals resting in the sun. Some adjust their position to get comfortable. Just like we do. Others inch their way up the beach to rest from swimming and warm in the sun. Outside the seawall are rocks, which are exposed during low tide. Groups of mollusks cling to the outer perimeter of the seawall. On any sunny day, the children's pool is just right for a postcard. To the south of Cuvier Park are the La Jolla Tidepools. This area reveals itself during low tide. As you can see, it attracts many visitors looking for creatures within the tide pools. Of course, we're only allowed to look, not take. There must be hundreds or thousands of tide pools formed by the sea over the years. Again, the sand carves them out with agitation from the ocean. This seagull is looking for creatures too, but he is allowed to take what he finds. Mussels are close to the water's edge, even at low tide. Massive rocks get shaped by the ocean. These channels were cut apart and widened. All the ocean needs is wind and time. The rocks look like an alien landscape, but the water and waves reassure us we're still on Earth. Notice how the sharp edges are made smooth over time by the water. These seagulls are looking for food to eat. Either they didn't find any here, or they just don't like being on camera. Low tide gives birds access to the plants and animals normally out of their reach. It's a good place to relax. channels in the rock look like mini rivers or streams. The tide pools invite guests to enjoy the view of the sea. The beachfront houses have sight of the ocean year-round. Over time, water shapes the rock into miniature canyons. If you get close enough, it really does seem like a river canyon. High tide will engulf several feet of these rocky outcroppings. On a good day, kids can explore all the way up to the water's edge. Some of the best views at the La Jolla tide pools are seen when you are further away. La Jolla Cove is one of the best places for families to gather and experience everything. Nearby parking is limited, but one look at the cove proves a short walk is worth it. There's a small sea cave on the west end where sea lions like to hang out. Next to it are many rocks where seals and sea lions rest and recover. Children play in the sand and enjoy the incoming waves. Most adults don't want to get wet, and it's quite the opposite for kids. Seagulls watch over us above the eastern side. La Jolla Cove faces north, allowing the California coast to wrap around the horizon and provide a scenic backdrop for guests on the beach. Next to the ocean is a park lined with palm trees. With space for families to picnic and enjoy the sea breeze. The trees grow slantwise, the wind made them bent. You'll see a dog run through and wonder where he went. The park is named after Ellen Browning Scripps, a journalist, an educator, and philanthropist. We appreciate the park, but it's sad to say, there used to be a special tree standing here one day. It was called the Lorax tree, and old age was the excuse. It fell after being portrayed in a book by Dr. Seuss. Despite the loss of that truffula tree, the park has many others that are still pleasing to see. Some are gnarled and belong in a forest enchanted. And others are creatures frozen in time while they slanted. They may see the future, the present, and past. We acknowledge their wisdom for their ability to outlast. These trees of Scripps Park are a strange phenomenon and may still be standing long after we're gone. If you enjoyed this video, please like, share, and subscribe. Thanks for watching San Diego Reviews.